Shambhunath Group of Institutions, shaping the future.
My dear students, Corona bhagao, desh bachao, samaj ko bachao. In this atmosphere, I am sending you another lecture in IPC, and that is Offences Relating to Marriage. Chapter 20 of the Indian Penal Code deals with offences relating to marriage. This section contains, this chapter contains a group of sections, section 493 to 498, which deal with these offences. Subsequently, in 1983, one more chapter was added to Indian Penal Code, which deals with cruelty by husband or relatives of the husband, and it was added by the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1983 with effect from December 25, 1983. Thus, all these offenses can be classified into following categories. Number one, mock marriages or deceitful marriages, which are given under section 493 and 496. Second is bigamy, dealt with under section 494 and 495. Third is adultery under section 497. And fourth is enticing or taking away with criminal intent a married woman. It is under section 498. And last, cruelty by husband or his relatives under section 498A. My dear students, I advise you to study some of these sections, that is section 493, 496 and 498 by yourself, as these sections are very simple and will pose no problem before you. You have already some idea of these sections through your regular classes. I will here cover in this lecture, and that too in very brief, the offenses of bigamy, adultery and cruelty to wife one by one. The first topic I will take up here is the offense of bigamy. This offense has been defined under section 494 of Indian Penal Code, and the punishment up to 7 years and fine is also provided in this section. If you go through this section, you will find that following necessary ingredients are there for this section. Number one, that the accused was already married to someone through a valid marriage. Number two, the earlier spouse is living and the marriage is subsisting at the time of second marriage. And third, that the accused person has married again with another person. At the time of this marriage, the earlier marriage is subsisting, the spouse is living, and that earlier marriage was a valid marriage. These are the conditions for the application of section 494. Thus, if first marriage is invalid or it has ceased to exist, no offense of bigamy is committed by entering into the marriage relationship for the next time. What is a valid marriage and how does such a marriage ceases to exist is a matter governed by personal law of the spouses. Because the validity of the marriage, what are the conditions of marriage, what conditions should be fulfilled in marriage, all these things, they are governed by the personal law. Thus, in case of Hindus, you know that marriage is a sacrament and is considered a relationship of several lives. Janma janmantar ka sambandh kaha jata. A Hindu is thus not absolved of his civil obligations by apostasy. Apostasy means abandonment of one's religion. So if a Hindu abandons his religion, he ceases to be a Hindu, but the civil obligations do not they remain with him. So if a Hindu husband or wife marries another person after apostasy, no bigamy is committed. Further, in Sarala Mudgal case of 1995, Supreme Court, and again in Lily Thomas case, which was decided by the Supreme Court in the year 2000, it was held that a Hindu husband who, after conversion to Islam, contracted second marriage, dissolving the first marriage, would be guilty of bigamy, because civil obligations were there with him. So he was not absolved of those civil obligations and he will be guilty of marriage. If a person apostates from Islam, his marriage being a contract comes to an end and the wife will not be guilty of bigamy if she marries through second marriage. Similarly, in other religions also, the consequence of the second marriage, whether it will be a bigamy or not, it will depend on the personal law of the spouses. In this connection, you must remember following three things in relation to bigamy. Number one, that in bigamy, mens rea in the form of guilty knowledge is an essential element of this offense. A bona fide belief is a good defense in bigamy. You might remember the case of R versus Tolson, which was told to you in the topic mens rea in the earlier semester. There, the wife had married under a belief that her husband was dead. But later on, it turned that he was alive and appeared on the scene just before the completion of 7 years. So technically it was a case of bigamy, but the court said that because her belief was bona fide, she will be not guilty of the offense of bigamy. Second point to remember is that a priest having knowledge of the earlier marriage, if he presides a second marriage, then he will be guilty of abetment under section 494, read with section 109 of Indian Penal Code. And the third thing is that the cognizance of bigamy case can be taken only on complaint of the party aggrieved or a close relative of the aggrieved party. This is provided under section 198 of Indian Penal Code. This is all I had to tell you about this bigamy. Now, the next topic is adultery. Adultery is defined under section 497 of Indian Penal Code. A reading of this section makes it clear that the scope of 497 is limited to the act of a man alone. That is to say, adultery is committed only by a man who has sexual intercourse with the wife of another man without the consent of other man or without his connivance. The punishment for adultery as given in section is 5 years or with fine or with both. So there can be either imprisonment or fine or both can be there, and the punishment will extend up to 5 years. But without going into further details, it is necessary to point out that the Supreme Court has decriminalized the offense of adultery and declared that section 497 is unconstitutional. In the case of Joseph Singh versus Union of India in the year 2018, only 2 years back. This was a very important case, and its validity of this section 494 was already decided by the Supreme Court under Yusuf Abdul Aziz versus State of Bombay. It was a case decided in March 1954. But this validity or the virus of this section was again challenged, and this case Joseph Singh versus Union of India decided in 2018 decided that this section is ultra vires. The Supreme Court held that section 497 is an archaic law and is constitutionally invalid. The court observed that sexual autonomy is a value and falls within Article 21 of the Constitution. This value should be treated with dignity and equality. The Supreme Court said that equality in the choice of sex should be given to the women also. And it said that this section denies substantive equality regarding women as unequal participants in the marriage relationship. So this section is arbitrary and it violates Article 14 of the Constitution. Supreme Court further said that this will not be an offense because it violates Article 14 of the Constitution. It can at most be a civil offense, means that the ground of adultery can be pleaded in cases of divorce, but it will not be a criminally punishable offense henceforth. The Supreme Court further observed that this section shows, the wording of this section is that the other person commits sexual intercourse without the consent of the husband or without his connivance, then it is adultery. The Supreme Court said that this section deals the wife as a chattel, as a property of the husband. Thus, it is violative of Article 14. So, in this case, the Supreme Court has totally declared this section as unconstitutional, and henceforth it has decriminalized the act of adultery. Now it is no more an offense. So the present position is that adultery is not a criminal offense. It is at most a civil offense, which means this ground can be pleaded as a ground for divorce only. After this, I come to the third topic, cruelty by husband or relatives of the husband. As I told you earlier, that this chapter was added in IPC in the year 1983 and section 498 was introduced in the Indian Penal Code afresh. The object of this chapter is to punish the husband and his relatives who torture and harass a woman with a view to coerce her or any person related to her to meet the unlawful demands or drive the woman to commit suicide. The purpose of introducing this section and the amendment of 1983 is to prevent the offense of dowry taking. Dowry taking has already been declared as unlawful, but the instances of dowry and also the practice of harassing a woman for bringing dowry, they were very common in the society. So in order to prevent this offense, this new amendment in IPC was brought. The purpose of this section in IPC is to prevent cruelty by the husband or his relatives and to extract who extract dowry thereby. The punishment provided under this section is up to 3 years imprisonment with fine. There is explanation to this section which defines cruelty, and the cruelty may be either a physical cruelty or a mental cruelty. Both are covered in the definition given in the explanation to 498A. The term relatives of husband has been used in the section, but this term has not been defined in the section. So the Supreme Court had to interpret this term relatives in a case, and the Supreme Court said that all those persons who are related with the husband with a blood relation, who are blood relations of the husband, come under this category. But in no case a friend can be treated as a relative for the purposes of section 498A. As I told you, that this amendment in 1983 was made with a view to check the offense of dowry in society. So, with this section, one more section was added in IPC, that is 304B, which deals with dowry death. So if death of the wife is also caused within 7 years of marriage and death is unusual in nature, that is, it has been caused by burns or by some other bodily injury, then section 113B of Indian Evidence Act and section 304B of Indian Penal Code also come into play. So, if cruelty is done and through that cruelty the husband or his relatives try to coerce the wife to bring dowry from her parents, then section 498A. And if They coerce her, or they practice cruelty to such an extent that death is also caused. And this death has been caused within 7 years of the celebration of marriage. And it is under unusual circumstances. Then section 304B says that they will be liable for dowry death. Section 113 of Indian Evidence Act makes a presumption that such death is on account of dowry demand, and the burden is on the accused to prove that it was otherwise. So, death caused in such circumstances will be presumed to be a dowry death, and if the husband or relatives want to prove it otherwise, the burden is on those persons. Section 304B punishes dowry death, and punishment provided is a minimum of 7 years. But this is minimum, and punishment may also extend up to life imprisonment. So, this group of sections 498A, 304B and 113B were added through an amendment of 1983 to prevent the offense of dowry by coercing or causing death of any woman within 7 years of marriage. But there is no such limit in the case of 498A. Limit is only for presumption of dowry death under section 113B of Indian Evidence Act and dowry death under 304B. So this is
Shambhunath Group of Institutions, a mentor for glorious transformations.